Our text this evening, beloved, is on Hebrews 5, verses 8 and 9. The first half of that text speaks of the Son's amazing condescension. Though he were a son, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered. And that is the equivalent in the language of Hebrews to that celebrated passage in Philippians 2, which states that Christ Jesus, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. And both passages in Philippians 2 and in Hebrews 5 go on to speak of the result and the reward of Christ's humiliation. In Philippians 2, it is Christ's exaltation. God has highly exalted him because he did this and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus Christ, every name, every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things on earth and things under the earth. And in our text, the wonderful result of Christ's amazing condescension is this, that being made perfect, Hebrews 5 verse 9, he became the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him. We're going then to look at the Son's amazing condescension. First of all, what? That's verse 8. And then with what result? The opening parts of verse 9. And then for whom was this amazing condescension? And that's at the end of verse 9. Three questions then involving the Son's amazing condescension. What, with what result, and for whom? The subject of our text this evening is the Son. What is meant by the Son in verse 8? Though he were a son, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered. Does this refer to Christ as a human son? That is, his humanity. Well, one would expect a human son to learn. That's why we teach them. One would expect a human son to obey, because God puts them under us and they need to be trained and we discipline and train them. One would expect a human son to suffer, because children get sick more often than adults. They cut their knees, they take knocks, and childhood at times seems to be nothing else but tears. But Hebrews 5 verse 8 speaks of these things, learning and obeying and suffering, as unexpected. There's the concessive. Though he were a son, although he was a son, even though he was a son, yet unexpectedly, he learned obedience by the things which he suffered. So Christ's sonship in this verse of itself would not lead you to expect learning, obedience, or suffering. And so the word son here in verse 8 refers to him not as a human son, but as a divine son. It points not to his humanity, but to his deity. It refers to him as the Son of God. though he were the Son of God, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered. And you might be surprised at how often and how richly Hebrews refers to Christ's divine sonship. Here are three verses that call him the Son of God. Chapter 4, verse 14. Seeing then that we have a great high priest that has passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. That Son, in heaven, let's hold on to our confession. Chapter 7, verse 3 says the Son of God, says of the Son of God, that Melchizedek was like him in some things. Melchizedek was without father, without mother, without descent, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but made like unto the Son of God, who abides a priest continually. Here's chapter 10, verse 29, which explains that since he's the Son of God, apostasy from him is great sacrilege. Hebrews 10, 29, of how much sorer punishment, suppose ye, shall he be thought worthy who hath trodden under foot the Son of God and hath counted the blood of the covenant wherewith he was sanctified an unholy thing and hath done despite unto the Spirit of God. Aside from those three references to the phrase Jesus as the Son of God, in fact, the whole of the first chapter of Hebrews, the opening chapter, has a lot to say about Christ's sonship. Turn with me to Hebrews 1. The epistle begins, God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son. So he is God's final and greatest word. So Muhammad is ruled out in his book, the Quran, and Joseph Smith in the Book of Mormon, gone. God has spoken by his Son. You can't add to that. And so the Son here is far greater than all the Old Testament prophets, because he is the supreme revealer of the Father. And then the passage goes on to say this about the Son. He's the heir of the universe, the one whom God has appointed heir of all things. He is the creator as well as the heir of the universe, by whom also God made the worlds. How is he related to the Father? Verse 3 says, he is the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person. So the Son, therefore, is presented as the divine effulgence, the light that emanates from God, as it were, the perfect likeness of the Father. So that the Son perfectly reflects the Father. In other words, speaking of his eternal generation. And what more does it say about the Son? It says that he is the providential governor of all things, upholding all things by the word of his power. Verse 3. He is the successful purger of our sins. When he had by himself purged our sins, he is the enthroned king at God's right hand. He sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. And so he is so much better, infinitely better than the angels, says verse 4, as is evident from these two rhetorical questions, verse 5. For unto which of the angels said he at any time, thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee? And again, I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. None of them.
And then we have another contrast between the angels as God's created servants and the Son as the divine Lord. Verse 7. Of the angels, he saith, who maketh his angels spirits and his ministers a flame of fire. But, verse 8 says, unto the Son, he saith, thy throne, O God, calls the Son God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of thy kingdom. There's the contrast. And then verses 10, 11, and 12 teach us that this divine Son, who's spoken of in the previous verses, this divine Son is the unchangeable Creator in contrast to the changeable creation. Verse 10, Thou, Lord, addressed to the Son, Thou, Lord, in the beginning hast laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the work of thine hands, O divine Son. They, the heavens and the earth, they shall perish, but thou remainest. And they all shall wax old as doth a garment, and as a vesture shalt thou fold them up, and they shall be changed. But thou art the same, and thy years shall not fail. And so in our text, Hebrews 5 verse 8 talks about the Son. It's referring back to the Son of whom chapter 1 has spoken so eloquently. Though he were a son, the one mentioned various points to the epistle, especially in the opening chapter, though he were a son, that son, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered. The only begotten Son of God, God's eternal Son, even God the Son. And even though he was the Son, yet he learned. The omniscient God, the one who knew all things, learned things. The eternal Word learned. Even though he were the eternal Son, yet he obeyed. He's the one who commands all things in the universe, who upholds all things by the word of his power, who speaks so that things exist and move and have their form and have their being, and yet he obeyed. The one who is the absolute Lord of Lords obeyed. Even though he were the Son, yet he suffered. The God who is above pain, and God is emphatically above pain, ever blessed, he suffered. The God who is invisible spirit and without body to suffer, yet he suffered. And how then can this amazing condescension of the divine Son be true? And the answer is that the text speaks of this divine Son, the Son of God, yes, but it speaks of him according to his human nature. In the days of his weakened flesh, in the state of his humiliation upon the earth. And for proof, look at verse 7. It begins, who in the days of his flesh, flesh and blood can't enter the kingdom of heaven or receive it. That's his flesh on earth, his weakened flesh. When he offered up prayers and supplications with strong crying and tears unto him that was able to save him from death. So here he's living on earth, the mortal one, before he died, making these prayers. And he was heard and that he feared. And you ask, when did this happen? That's a reference to Gethsemane. Christ, the Son of God, in his human nature, in his weakened flesh, in his state of humiliation on earth, though he were a son, the divine Son, verse 8 continues, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered while on earth in his weakened flesh, in his state of humiliation. though he were a son, yet he learned. And Jesus Christ most definitely did learn according to his human nature. We read this especially at the end of Luke 2. There the boy Jesus increased in wisdom, he learned, and stature, he grew taller, and in favor with God and man. He learned, of course, according to his human nature, which very obviously admitted increase of knowledge. And even as an adult, and even in his public ministry, he said in his great discourse about the end of the world and the events leading up to it, amazing knowledge that God gave him, but he said, I don't know everything according to my human nature, because of the day and the hour the Father knows, but the Son doesn't know. He knew according to his divine nature, because he's omniscient, but according to his human nature, he didn't know, because it wasn't granted to him then to know. Though he were a son, yet learned he. What did he learn? According to our text, he learned other things, but what did he learn according to our text? Yet learned he obedience. And that's a great thing for any son or a daughter to learn. That's probably the thing that your parents most want you to learn. They want you to learn your times tables and all the rest, but they're delighted when they see you learning obedience. That's even greater than learning your homework. Obedience. When we say here that Jesus Christ learned obedience, we don't mean that he went from disobedience to obedience. We don't even mean that he went from imperfect, flawed, and partial obedience to a perfect and sinless obedience. This is the way of it. This is what it means when it says of Christ that he learned obedience. Jesus Christ was always sinless. His obedience was always sinless, even as a tiny baby. He grew in obedience and learned obedience then, in that he developed so that he was able to obey in more and more difficult circumstances. His obedience was always sinless. He always did what he was told to do. But the obedience of which he was capable when he was a child was somewhat limited. And then he learned to obey in harder, more difficult, more strenuous, more awkward situations. Philippians 2 verse 8, in a different way, because as I said at the start, these two passages are similar and sheds lights on each other. Philippians 2 verse 8 puts it this way. He humbled himself and became obedient unto death. It's one thing to put out the bin for your mother, and another thing to obey by teaching the truth in his public ministry when people hated him. But to obey unto death is a greater obedience. So there he's learning obedience. He humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. But to continue with Hebrews 5 verse 8. Though he were a son, even though he was the Son of God, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered. The sufferings in this context are first of all the sufferings of the Garden of Gethsemane, spoken of in verse 7, as I said earlier. In the days of his flesh, he offered up prayers, and not only prayers, supplications, more earnest prayers. He did this with strong crying in the vehemency of his soul, and with tears, so that he wept as he prayed. And he did this unto the one who is able to save him from death. You remember his prayer, Father, if it's possible, take this cup from me, yet not my will, but thine be done. And he was heard, and that he feared. So there he was, in these prayers, sweating in the Garden of Gethsemane, as it were, great drops of blood, because the shadow of the cross loomed dark over him. If it's possible, take the cup away. It's too awful. Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. And you say, but wasn't that disobedience? No, that was obedience. Because he said, never, thy will be done. That's what I want to do. I want to obey. He was always obedient. He got the answer to the prayer, thy will be done, and the strength to do it. And he learned emphatically by the closing of that door that there was no other way. There could be no other way. And he was resolved to go through with his calling. He learned obedience by the things which he suffered. And verse 7 says this included Gethsemane. But this included Gethsemane as it ushered him to the cross. Because you don't think of Gethsemane as an isolated event all by itself. It was a prelude to Golgotha. The hellish agony suffered by the Son of God as the just one dying for the unjust that he might bring us to God. So here we have then his lifelong suffering heightened to the depths of the cross. He obeyed his parents, his biological and adoptive parents. He obeyed his father as a boy. He learned obedience, more difficult obedience, as a man before he was called to his official public ministry for over a decade then. He learned more difficult obedience when he entered his public ministry with the baptism that he received at the hand of John the Baptist, his forerunner. He learned obedience even more so after 40 days in the wilderness being tempted of the devil. He learned obedience in the face of rejection and hatred, despite great weariness of body and soul. He learned obedience at Gethsemane. He learned obedience at his trial. He learned obedience on the cross. And though he were a son, even though he was a son of God, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered. His obedience, lifelong. And his sufferings were lifelong too. And his learning, lifelong. And I want, before we move on, I want you to feel something of the force of this. I'll give you a couple of weak, very definitely and admittedly they are weak, earthly illustrations. Think of a businessman, a man who owns a multi-million pound company. Even though this businessman owns the whole thing, one of the most wealthy businesses in all the world, he mops his floor every night. Doesn't get one of his workers to do it. He does it himself. Pulls out the mop. You think, he does that himself? Seriously? Why does he not get... But he can pay somebody to do that at a pittance. He does it himself. Imagine the most expensive sportsman in the world, who has a market value of millions, and he cleans his own boots. In fact, he cleans the boots of the whole team. Even though he's the greatest sportsman in the world with the greatest value, he cleans his own boots. And he cleans the boots of his teammates. Even though. Those are very weak illustrations, but I want you to get the far greater point of verse 8. Even though he were the Son of God, yet he learned obedience by the things which he suffered. That's the amazing condescension of the Son of God, God the Son, for us. He did it for us. And with what result? Verse 9 says, and being made perfect. Being made perfect. That is, by learning obedience to the things that he suffered, He was made perfect. And again, I need to explain this. It's this reference to perfection isn't to be understood in terms of sin. It is not saying that formerly he was not sinlessly perfect. And then he learned obedience to the things that he suffered. And then he began to live in a sinlessly perfect way. No, he had no sin and he knew no sin. You see, perfection can apply in different ways. It's not here sinlessly perfection. The perfection spoken of in the text is perfection regarding his work and office as priest. That ought not be any surprise to you, because that's what the book of Hebrews is all about. That's especially what the first half and more of the book of Hebrews is all about, as we saw in the Belgian Confession class when we looked at the priesthood of Jesus Christ. And this is very obvious in the chapter we looked at, and just before our text and after our text. Perfection here regarding to his office as priest. Look at verse 6. As he saith also in another place, thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Verse 5 begins, so also Christ glorified not himself to be made an high priest. Verses 5 and 6 talk about Christ as high priest. Then verse 7 begins saying about this high priest that in the days of his flesh and at Gethsemane, that's a priestly act. Here he is as high priest, interceding for not himself, not his people, but here himself. He's praying, though he were a son, this great high priest, he's learning obedience to the thing which he suffered, and he's suffering as a high priest, and being made perfect as a high priest. And then verse 10 continues, part of the same sentence, called of God, an high priest after the order of Melchizedek. I didn't make this up. This is what perfection in this context, that is in this book and in this chapter and in these verses, he was made perfect as a priest. It's not dealing with sinless perfection here. He was sinlessly perfect, but the perfection here deals with his perfection as a priest. And another word for perfection with regard to one's priestly office is that he was perfectly set apart to the work of a high priest. He was perfectly dedicated and consecrated to that calling. That's the idea. So that when you see Jesus, let's say, as a 7-year-old boy or a 12-year-old boy in the temple, he's a priest, all right, but he's not perfectly consecrated in that work as a priest. He hasn't even yet been ordained to his public ministry. And when you see him teaching in Galilee, he's a priest, but he's not made perfect in that work as a priest, because he yet must learn, he has more to learn, he yet must obey in more and more difficult circumstances, and he yet must suffer, because he's our suffering high priest. He must be perfected, more and more dedicated and consecrated to his task as high priest. And he even speaks of that in his high priestly prayer in John 17. Father, I sanctify myself. I set myself apart more and more to my calling as priest, because tomorrow I'm going to the cross. And when this text says that Christ was made perfect as a priest, there's a contrast here between the Son of God in his priesthood and the Old Testament priests in their priesthood. The Old Testament priests were often ignorant and disobedient. In fact, many of them, and I dare say the majority of them, were actually unbelievers. Verse 2 says that the high priest can have compassion on the ignorant and on them that are out of the way. Ignorant, they don't know much of God's will. And those who are out of the way, they're disobeying God's will. For that he himself also is compassed or surrounded with infirmity. That is, he's ignorant of God's will in many particulars too, and he often strays because he's a sinner who disobeys the Lord too. But then, and there's a contrast throughout Hebrews 5 between these Old Testament Aaronic priests and the priesthood of Jesus Christ. But then Jesus Christ, he learns obedience. That is, he learns to obey in more and more difficult situations. There's a contrast too, not only between the learning and the obedience, but there's a contrast too as regards the suffering. The suffering that's involved in the priesthood of Jesus Christ and the suffering that's involved in the priesthood of the sons of Aaron. Suffering was involved in the consecration of the Aaronic priests to their office. They couldn't become priests without suffering. But the suffering wasn't their own suffering. It was the suffering of the sacrificial beasts. And that's the way it was meant to be. In a world with sin, there has to be suffering and death. You can no more avoid suffering for animals than you can avoid suffering for human beings. It's a sin-cursed world and you've got to work with it. There was suffering involved in the consecration of the priests, in their dedication to their office when they were first installed. It wasn't their own. It was the suffering of one bullock and two rams. Exodus 29, Leviticus 8. That is, those animals suffered in their brutal deaths. But Jesus Christ wasn't made a high priest through some sacrifice that was offered at the temple. There was a suffering, though, that consecrated him to his priestly work. But it wasn't an animal on his behalf. It was his own sufferings. His own sufferings. He was consecrated to his priestly office by and in his own sufferings. Not now at the very start of his priestly work, but as it were, at the very end of his priestly work. And the Son of God didn't need a bullock or rams to be offered up to put him into his office. This happened, the perfection of Christ in his priesthood, through his learning, through his learning obedience by things which he suffered, all according to the Father's sovereign disposition, with Jesus Christ obediently submitting to his Father's will, which included the external means of his sufferings all life long, and especially on the cross. And you should be able to see it, the argument of the apostle. Though Christ were the Son of God, yet he learned obedience by the things which he suffered, and God made him perfect in his priesthood. And so, here's the second reward and result of this obediential suffering that he learned. He became the author of eternal salvation. And the word author here might make you think of someone who writes a book, but the word author's wider than that, of course. The original Greek carries the idea of cause. He became the author or cause of our salvation. And he is the author or cause of our salvation in at least two main ways. He is the purchasing cause of our salvation. He learned obedience through his sufferings. He's perfected in his priesthood. And so he purchased, as a priest, our salvation by his meritorious life and death. His perfect obedience for us and his sufferings on our behalf. He purchased our salvation for us. And as well as being the purchasing cause of our salvation, he is the applying cause of our salvation, because he applies to us the salvation that he purchased for us. And he does this as a high priest through his intercession. He prays for us at God's right hand. And he prays for us that his Spirit, as his vicar or representative, would act on his behalf by working God's salvation in us, so that we're saved from the penalty of our sins, and the power of our sins, and the pollution of our sins. And we're saved to have fellowship with the living triune God in the new and better covenant, which is established in Christ's blood, as the book of Hebrews teaches again and again and again. And this salvation is called eternal salvation. And it's called eternal salvation in part, think of the book of Hebrews, in contrast to the Old Testament priesthood and its sacrifices and deliverances. Through that Old Testament priesthood, with the slaying of animals and the sprinkling of their blood and the ashes of a heifer and all the rest, you could be saved, all right, in a weak sense. You could be saved from ceremonial uncleanness. That's all. Saved from ceremonial uncleanness. For a time. Until you stub your toe against a dead animal or a bone jutting out of the ground. Or until there's some bodily issue, then you're unclean again. You need to be saved or delivered from that. And then you have these sacrifices, and the sacrifices which keep you from ceremonially uncleanness, let's say the Day of Atonement, bring it up, has to be done again and again, year after year. Whereas Christ's salvation isn't temporary for a time, or even temporal, it's eternal. Because it's based on the sacrifice of the Son of God, who offered himself up once and for all. A final word from God, Hebrews 1 verse 2, and a final all-conquering sacrifice. And so we can't be lost. The preservation, and therefore the perseverance of all the saints, and the eternal joys of the new heavens and the new earth. And finally, Christ's amazing condescension as the Son of God. For whom? Not for everybody. Only for those who hear Jesus Christ and follow him and do as they are told. That's what verse 9 says. Being made perfect, he became the author of eternal salvation, not for everybody, but unto all them that obey him. And we need to understand the role of obedience in our salvation in this text. It is not saying, the book of Hebrews doesn't teach this, nor does any of the other 65 books in the Bible say this. It is not saying that our obedience earns salvation for us. That's the gross heresy of justification by works, whereby we merit and earn our own salvation and glory. That's not the idea. What it's saying is that obedience marks or characterizes all those who are saved, because those whom Jesus saved are grateful. How in the wide world could you be saved and not be grateful? And those who are grateful or thankful are obedient. So when it says that Jesus became the author or cause of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him, it's not we obey him and therefore we're saved. No, he saves those who are currently obeying him because he has saved us from the power and guilt and bondage of sin. Therefore, we obey him. This then is the comfort for all the people of God. Do you obey Jesus Christ? I'm not asking. I think that would be a very cruel thing to ask. And it would cause everybody to despair. Do you perfectly obey him? There isn't anybody who ever did. Do you obey him as faithfully as you ought to? I'm not asking that. I'm not asking, do you obey him as much as you want to obey him? The answer to all those questions would have to be no. But do you obey Jesus Christ? And every Christian says in his heart, feeling guilty for his sins, no doubt, but he says, I do obey him. I do. And it's my sincere desire to obey him more faithfully. And I hate it when I don't. That's Romans 7. And that's the cry of every Christian's heart. And all those who obey him must know. And all those who do not obey him feel that in their conscience too and say, I'm not saved. Because that's the other side of it. But all those who do obey him, to you, God says, this is a key of the kingdom of heaven. The doors are open to you. The door has been unlocked. You've been brought in. The door has been locked. You're on the inside, in the citadel of salvation. Yours is an eternal salvation. You can't lose it. And it is wonderful. And it's going to be far, far, far better than the best of your salvation as you've enjoyed it in this life. And it's never going to end. Because he's the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him. And here then, of course, is our calling. And with this we end. Our calling in the days of our own flesh, our own weakened flesh, on earth, to echo verse 7. All those who are saved by the blood of Christ are commanded to imitate the example of Christ. We follow Jesus Christ here below. He learned obedience by the things which he suffered. Then we learn of him. We learn his word. We learn his way. He learned obedience. We learn. And we teach our children too to learn to obey the first table of the law. To love God with all your heart, soul, strength and mind. And to keep the second table. To love your neighbor as yourself. And to take up your cross. He learned obedience. He learned obedience by the things which he suffered. And that's the way for all the people of God. You suffer with Christ. And you suffer for Christ. For though he were the Son of God, yet he learned obedience by the thing which he suffered. And now we in him are the sons and daughters of God. And so we must learn. We must learn obedience by the things that we suffer too. Amen. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, bless to us thy word, and may we look for that eternal salvation found in our perfected priest Jesus Christ at thy right hand, so that we learn ourselves obedience by the things which we too suffer in him. Give us this grace and blessedness, we pray. Amen.